Fans tuning in to this broadcast might be expecting the familiar AOR doubleheader format. And if there ever was a track where a driver would like a second chance, it is our venue today. But that's not the case. Drivers will have one chance to get it right, or for the glass half-empty crowd, one chance to get it wrong. From the Nürburgring Nordschleife, it's Apex Online Racing's Formula Renault 2.0 Season 10 Championship. And all the simulated open wheel action, from green flag to victory donuts, can be seen live as it happens here on the Global Sim Racing Channel. Guten Schled McNock Mittag, and welcome to GSRC's Countdown to Green, and that's the last German you're going to hear from me. As cyberspace flows into this place over these 15 Streamy Award-worthy minutes, GSRC will bring you all the storylines, all the stats and facts you'll need to fully appreciate not the usual doubleheader format, but a rare for this series single race event that will immediately follow as we count down to green for round 7 of 12 on the AOR Formula Renault 2.0 Season 10 Championship schedule. And here to do all of that is yours truly, Bill Soupzon, joined way up in the press box to bring you our bird's eye view by the hardest working man in sim race broadcasting, Joe Pete. In the director's chair, it's Sean Crackers Ambrose, armed with cameras located, aimed, zoomed, and focused by GSRC's camera guru, Dougie Beard. Now, Joe, this place is big, and you get the unenviable task of trying to help the viewers understand what this place is all about.
Well, how do you sum up the ring quickly? I mean, just looking at the stats gives you a sense of the scale of this place. Almost 13 miles long, or just under 21 kilometers. You've got 154 turns to tackle and over 1,000 feet of elevation change. If that doesn't make your jaw drop, you're either already pretty familiar with this track, or you're simply not a racing fan and don't understand the significance of those numbers. This place is monstrous. It's kind of incredible to think they used to run Formula One here and during its most dangerous period. In fact, this track has been around for more than 90 years, which is a testament to how highly regarded it is in the racing world. You'd think it's simply a leftover of a time gone by, but they still hold a 24-hour race on the combined circuit every year, and it is hugely popular. Unfortunately, we don't have time to show you the whole track in the lap guide, but let's jump on board anyway, just to see this beast from the driver's perspective.
All right, we've got Juhan Orlampi in the GSRC Lotus 79, so let's do a lap around the Nürburgring. First corner up is the north curve, and the downhill braking will make it easy to overshoot it. Now we're going to skip ahead to the important parts of the lap since we don't have time for a full one. A critical set of corners is High Oaks. This right-left combo takes you onto a long, flat-out stretch where you won't be braking until Ehrenberg. Make sure you get a good exit. Up ahead, the Swedish Cross is flat out, but make sure to stay to the left of Nauerforst. As the track weaves back and forth, you're constantly slowing the car. Take it wide into the last left-hander so that you can get onto the power early as it veers back right. Later on in the track, once we're heading downhill, you've got to weave through the Spiegel curve and then get ready for miss-hit-miss. Use the apexes like the Neymar lift, but Bergwerks is as critical as ever. Send it in deep, but open. Be easy on the throttle on your way out to avoid wheel spin, then line up the car for the carousel. It is going to be very bumpy through here, and you really can't get back fully on the gas at a straight line these S's. Make sure to line up the car on the left, and though you still get light over the jump into Flansgarten, you won't get air like most cars do. Double apex the uphill, and then we're going to skip over to Swallowtail. Your slow comes the most important corner on the track, Gallows Hill. Getting through that first bit cleanly is important so that you can get a difficult proposition of slowing while turning and then avoiding the tall curbs on either side. The weirdly named...
An edited lap around Nürburgring's Nordschleife. The Nürburgrings. Okay, now, unlike today, the last round at Road Atlanta was a doubleheader event. Two races, two different scoring systems, but one driver who earned best of day honors. Joe, what do you got?
Well, Josh Thompson came out on top, not by much, but it was consistency that got it for him. with a third and a second. Now, what you might find interesting is Luke Barton, despite winning the first one, this goes back to show what we keep talking about. You need to finish high up in both races. That 14th meant that he did not earn as much as he could have, and that's why he wound up in second. Herman, also pretty consistent there. A pair of fours gets him up there into third. Now, Alex Sadler actually finished outside of the points in the sprint race. So that second place really is what gained him most of what you see there. And then Glenn Key rebounded, unusual here. Usually we see a bad race in the second one, but in him it was a bad race in the first one, and he won the sprint. And that's what gets him up there into fifth. The big question, though, always is how does this affect the points? And Bill, I think you got the update on that.
Yeah, GSRC continues to ease in the dropped events, taking into account last round, where we did the one round. Now we're going to take into account the best two of three possible dropped events. So in effect, this is represents a driver's four of six, best four out of six. The drop events play a big role in the points. When looking at raw points, Patrick Kessler leads his SimRC teammate, Renee Ostergaard, by 16. But because Kessler was forced to drop, get this, 53 total points. He had to drop a 20-pointer and then the big 33-pointer that's shown on the screen right there by his droplet. Renee Ostergaard, he only had to drop 4 points. He had a 1-pointer that he had to get rid of and then a 3-pointer that's shown up there. That means that Ostergaard actually leads by a whopping 33 points when you take into account the net points. This is an example of why the GSRC stat boys, Simon and Poindexter, continue to preach the importance of taking in drop events before you get to the end of the season. Stefan Herman had two zeros, so the SimRC retro driver, he's loving drop races. In contrast, Phil Reed had to drop a 25-pointer, shown on his row. He also had to drop a four-pointer, and that's why the AOR orange driver sits below Herman on this graphic, while above Herman on the raw total chart. And then rounding out the overlay is Manuel Hoyer. You know, he missed the first two events, so the Positive Racing green driver enjoying drop racing as well. Let's go ahead and look at the team championship now. And you know, drop races didn't have that big of effect down here as it did on the driver's race. The top four teams all hold station. SimRC still comfortably in the lead, thanks to Ostergaard and Kessler. Glenn Key and Manuel Hoyer, well, they still might have time to catch the front runners. And how about this? Welcome to the top five graphic, Radicals Online. That's Josh Thompson now doing what he does, and that's scoring. Remember, he was best today at Road Atlanta. And then Connor Ryan is having a great season, 14th overall. Now, this is only the second time GSRC has covered a single race event for AOR. So, Joe, how about we go over and figure out how this is going to work today?
Well, today, with us being in Season 10, they've been doing this for quite a while here in the AOR. And this is round 7 out of 12. They follow the official Formula Renault schedule here on iRacing. And we talked about those drops. They get three of them. Now, the single race that you mentioned, only 60 minutes. So relatively long compared to what they normally run, but not exactly endurance race by most car standards. The setups are open, and that's going to be kind of important today. Now, you can't really make this car perfect around the whole track. That's pretty much impossible with the amount of different types of turns that you have out there. But still, you want to be comfortable around here. That's really the thing that you need to try to aim for. And as you mentioned, the drivers probably won't want to screw up because they have no fast repairs, and it's going to take a long time to either take a tow or to simply try and limp the car back, which I really wouldn't advise if the car is handling bad and you have guys behind you. Now, this race itself, for the single race, let's talk a little bit more about that. We mentioned that it has 60 minutes, and the importance of that is that instead of having the regrid that they usually do, it is sequential out there. So they have the qualifying going on right now. And there is one pit stop that we can expect today, Bill. Not going to be a whole lot of variety that you'll see in that, although that they can go a few different ways on the fuel, but I'm pretty sure that you're going to see most guys take the same approach there because it's just not much that's going to do good for you, especially if you pit early and find yourself back in the middle of the pack. Now, Incident cap is at 17 today, and I doubt we'll see many drivers reach that. They'll probably wreck out before they reach 17 incident points. And what we mean by that is if you have a spin, you have contact with the wall or another car, or simply go off track, you rack up an incident point or a number of incident points. If you hit 17, you are disqualified right on the spot. You don't even get to finish the lap. Points for this one, though, Bill, very, very important. 52. It's effectively like doing the double, like we keep calling. Yep. So this race is maybe a little bit more important than the others.
You know, you talked about how hard it is to get your car to work well all the way around the track. One thing that is universal all the way around the track is the weather, despite how big this place is. What's it look like here today, Joe?
Well, so at the top, we have, it looks like about 78 degrees air temperature. So nice temperature out in the mountains, but 86 degrees on the track, which is just about ideal. This is exactly what the guys want. They really don't want to be slipping around with how bumpy this place is and how many crests there are. Humidity is only at 2%. So it's very dry out there today, which will mean a little bit higher speeds, thankfully.
And down that long straight on the back, boys, that's where speed is really going to come. These cars are really going to open it up. You know, talking about open it up, because this track is so long, they've opened up the qualifying time. They opened it up to 30 minutes rather than the few 10 minutes that they usually have. Rene Oosterkamp up on top. He put in a 6:29.6.
Watching David Boudelaar, who's going to give up on this lap, it looks like. And I think, let's see, Lubomir Morris is going to be the last one to actually try and finish a lap. Try to figure out where exactly he is, though. And I don't think he's going to get there in time, because right now he's heading through Defense Valley, which is not even halfway around.
And just two minutes left to go in qualifying. He's not going to make it for sure. You look at the size of the grid, I think that Germany scared away a lot of these drivers. We're a little small today. Only 18 drivers putting in qualifying times, 24 entries on the podium.
Remember, last round, we talked to one of the drivers who finished on the podium, asked if he would show up, and he was a straight no. This place is divisive, and very much in extreme ways, which suits a very extreme track. There are drivers who love this place, Bill. They love the challenge of it, and they see value in trying to just basically stay on the track, not necessarily be completely fast. And then there's the drivers that I think maybe they like to push that little bit too hard, and that's why they get punished so much harder, and they tend to not like this track, because it really does not settle fools lightly. If you make mistakes, you're probably going to pay in damage on the car and just your race being over.
I finally got my head around this place. By the way, I had to do it was to just break it up into sections, and this just think of it as, okay, now I'm running Spa, now I'm in Road Atlanta, now I'm running Sebring. Once I thought of it as like seven or eight different tracks, I started to get the hang for it. I realized where I was, rather than thinking of one big one all the way around. Qualifying is done. Let's go ahead and tell you what the order is right now, and I think everybody should be set. We're still looking at one driver putting in a time, but I don't think that time's going to count. So it is our point leader. It's Manuel Hoyer up on the top. He's going to be inside. Rene Oosterkamp. I'm sorry, Rene Oosterkamp inside of Manuel Hoyer. Then the Russian driver, Alexei Sorokin, in the third position. He's going to be inside of the Norwegian driver, Glenn Key. Then Patrick Kessler from Switzerland, and Phil Reed, of course, from the UK. Sara Dove, how about this? She's up in seventh spot. She's going to be inside of Kerry Nolden, Lubomir Morris, and David Boudelaar round out your top 10.
Allie Hay going to be starting in 11th with Scott Newton, P12 at the drop of the green. Ryan Walker will be 13th, and Luke Barton, one of our winners from the last round, starting 14th. That's going to be hard for him to repeat. Thomas Andriami Harasoa starts in 15th with Evan Emre in 16th. John Roberts, P17 on the grid. Tom Van Hoymen will start in 18th. Daniel Morris, the first driver not to take a lap in qualifying, starts 19th. Joseph Ringrose, 20th. And Marvin Sluman will start in 21st.
21 names out there, like we talked about, a little bit smaller than usual. Right now, the drivers start to grid up. There will be a pit stop. I think Joe nailed it. I see no reason to come in early here. Lap traffic certainly not going to be an issue. I think you're just going to run it long, let the car be as light as you can, then come in for a late stop. Fuel really not an issue. They just have to come in and make a tire change. That's what the rule says. Anything but the last lap.
I think today, Bill, it's going to be all about one word, survival. Just get it to the finish and you'll have a good result.
Joe talked about the incident cap at 17. We rarely see anyone reach that incident cap because these walls are so close. You get off too many times, eventually you're going to find something that's going to hurt this little fragile French racing machine, and you're not going to be able to have a very good result.
Yeah,
Joe, go ahead. Have you started to feel comfortable with this track? You've raced on it a lot. You like this track, don't you?
I do love this track. In this car, I wouldn't say I was comfortable quite yet. I maybe got in about, I'd say, 7 or 8 laps, and only 3 of them had time. So that tells you the way I was struggling to try and find speed around here.
Still waiting for all the drivers to get their spot. Now they have. You can hear the engine start to harmonize a little bit as they start to rev up. Luke Barden wishes his best to the field. Luke coming off a win in the last round. Gather up the chickens, take cover behind the cows. The horses are out of the barn, and look right up front, stealing the spot. It's Manuel Hoyer. He gets a great jump on Rene Oosterkamp. Key, Sorokin, and Kessler round out your top 5.
Wow, he really stole a march on him, and that I think that was more down to Oosterkamp just not getting a good start and Hoyer being brave into the north curve, which is downhill, difficult braking. This whole first lap is going to be tough, Bill, because they are on cold tires, and I can tell you, the car gets a little sketchy. Oh, and our leaders almost come together. Sorry, Bill.
Oh, and that's Oosterkamp is off. He's going to get it back on, but he's going to lose a ton of spots.
He is going to get by. Kessler gets by. That was, they almost come together themselves. So the SimRC driver's not having a great first lap. And our leader, our pole sitter, is off the course and into the wall. I think Oosterkamp's day might already be done, Bill.
Boy, it did not last long. Meanwhile, while that's going on, there's a pass for the lead. And we have a new leader. It's Kessler.
No, Hoyer's still our leader. Kessler's just getting into second.
You know what?
Hoyer's running away with this.
Yeah, Hoyer had checked out so far that I thought that was the leaders up there. Kessler now into second.
And this is not where you want to be, Bill. Yeah, as they go side by side, this goes up into Outenauer Forest, and Reed understandably backs out, as that is a very marginal crest of that left-hander. Everybody slows up through left, right, and they get to stretch out their legs again. But the point I was making before, Bill, is that you got to be gentle on the power in a few places on this first lap until the tires warm up, because they're going to be a little skittish.
We got to stay right on second, because I'm telling you, Phil Reed is working left, working right, working both sides of the street like a jaywalking mailman, trying to find his way around Kessler.
And the reason that he wants to do this, Bill, is because even though you've got some of these long straights where the draft is going to allow you to just kind of slingshot by each other, if the driver ahead of you makes a mistake, it can often be really, really tough to avoid getting tangled up in that. So it's really better to just try and be ahead of everybody you can at all times so that you've got clear track.
From the back of the field, Ben Hoyman has had an issue. We'll come back and get that one a little bit later. Not nearly as consequential as the mistake that Oosterkamp has made.
Yeah, I'm pretty certain he's not going to be able to bring that car back out, because unless it gets repaired to a state that it's handling very well, he might gain a few spots, but even then, you risk wrecking the car all over again and wrecking somebody else's race. So we continue to watch this battle for second here between Reed and Kessler. This is exactly what I was talking about here, Bill. Reed with the draft, these cars punch a huge hole in the air, and it's uphill. So Reed's just going to take it easy.
Reed gets that pass made. out there racing in the 44 machine, but right behind him, Kessler not giving it up.
He's going to want to get right back in front of him, especially now that his teammate's gone. He's got to represent for his team. All the points are relying on Kessler.
Look back at who is racing in fourth position.
Ah, Little Bird.
Yeah. Up from seventh, there's Sara Dove.
I was kind of thinking that if Sara can cut out the mistakes today, she's in for a good finish. The main thing is just not doing what she tends to do, which is she usually makes little errors and that costs her positions. It's not going to be positions she worries about today, but just losing the whole car.
All this going on behind the man, they need to check his luggage for stolen towels because he has checked out, and we're talking about Manuel Hoyer. My goodness, almost 2.5 seconds. Ooh. Back. Oh my, you saw that too, Joe.
Yes, I did indeed. That was heading into, I believe, Ashbrook and out of Vipperman. He got really sideways.
Really sideways. You don't see these little Renaults do that very often. There's such heavy downforce. Good catch by Manuel Hoyer.
Oh, Sluman having some issues. He gets it back going, though. He's the last car on track right now, I think. But yeah, the thing about the reason you're seeing these cars get all sideways is even though they've got a fair bit of downforce, Bill, there's a number of spots where there's crests that you have to have the wheel straight effectively. If you're turned even just a little bit, it's going to get all loosey-goosey on you. And like I said, there's no room to really try and save it. So you just kind of have to have a lot of practice here and know those spots where you want to keep the wheel straight.
Let's go look at second now. After Reed got around Kessler, Reed was able to open it up and has closed the gap. Now, maybe some of that might have been Hoyer getting a little loose, but Reed's coming. I think Kessler is the cork in the bottle now as Dove is right behind him.
Yeah, there you see in the background, now on screen, Kessler just weaving back and forth to try and break this draft. So this is pretty much a hopeless effort. I really wouldn't bother scrubbing off speed if I was the car ahead. Just kind of let her go through. If anything, I almost would say it might be better to let the car through early, and then just repass them back with their draft. Because like I said, you want to be ahead of people. Especially if they're that little bit slower than you, that's even worse because they're holding you up through the rest of the track where it's so difficult to try and get by them.
I'm really good on Dottinger Hall. That's my best. I got that part down.
Until you try to check your phone, right, Bill? All right, around turn 13, they finished a lap. Reed, now the one who's checking out. And this train is very close together. They've been that way the whole first lap and now into the second.
Harry Nolden back in sixth spot, right behind, taking a look on Glenn Key.
Looking through, I think our biggest mover of this top group is Phil Reed up in second. He started sixth, Bill. He's gained a lot of positions.
And once Sara Dove gets around Kessler, which I think she's going to be able to do, she's going to follow Reed right up through the field.
That seems to be her plan, if she can get past Kessler, though. Now that he's gotten it back, she's kind of holding on. This is one of those long straightaways here through fluke plots.
She's alongside.
I was not able to go side by side through the Swedish cross. I have no idea how this is going to play out, Bill. It's flat out through there, and looks like Sara's going to give it up a little bit.
I really think she feels that once she gets around Kessler, she can do what Reed did as well and start to drive away.
I almost wonder if Kessler has a little bit of damage. I think we saw him making some slight contact with another car. Looks like our cameras aren't showing any right now. Whoa, just behind them.
That was Gary Nolden in like a rocket. Took it in deeper than Buddha's belly button. Got him load up. I really thought he was going to get in the back of Key.
as narrow as it is, and even though it seems like a one-line track, everybody kind of approaches the ring differently, Bill, and that's what we're seeing there. You got to be oh so careful how close you are behind someone. Because there are so many corners, there's a good chance that someone breaks way sooner than you do in some of them. And it looks like he's going to take a look on Dove. Didn't quite pull it off, though.
Dove loosened touch a little bit with Kessler. We've talked about the drivers up front all the way back to six, Kerry Nolden. Just to touch off the last part of your top 10, Lubomir Morris is all by himself in seventh. Still in shouting distance of Nolden. Allie Hay in eighth. A little farther back, Luke Barton coming off a win at Road Atlanta.
Tell you what, look at the 777 sitting in 12th place. Daniel Morris, he started in 19th. That's 7 positions up for him as well. He's still in the mid-pack. But again, you need to focus less on other people's races and more on yours. Right now, Daniel, he is in completely clean air. This is ideal for him right now.
I think we'll take a second here to look at what happened to Rene Oosterkamp early on, because this has not only ramifications on this race, but maybe into the championship as well. We'll bring that up whenever our director feels like it. We're going to the replay right now. There we go.
Curious which one, if it was his first off or his second off. It looks like we'll see the first off. This was after he lost the lead. He's the yellow car right there in the middle. Or is it? Oh, no. This is up to Fluke Plots, maybe? Oh, no, I had it wrong. It's hard to tell from above, Bill.
It sure is.
It's a lot of trees and a lot of trees that look like one another.
There it is.
There's the first off. Yeah. So that was into High Oaks. That set up what happened with the next part here, Bill. See, he was all out of speed. This is one of those long, flat-out sections. You're not going to be braking until Swedish Cross, even up into here over Flugplatz. Now, I'm not sure what exactly. I just saw him go off. Did he go a little wide?
Maybe a little bit of a hip check.
Oh, yeah. That is just not a place where you can do that sort of stuff. And the Armco is right there. Now, Hoyer seems to have recovered, Bill. It was at 1.6.
Yeah.
It's up to 1.9. But that's going to fluctuate a little bit because, again, even over a single lap, some drivers will be stronger in certain areas over others. So it'll be more over about the overall lap time and also whether or not that 44 can get close enough to get the slipstream.
And about a second and a half, probably too far back. Remember, we're only working
right
lap number two.
Yeah, if he gets it down to about 1.2, then you're going to see him suck right up to the gearbox of Hoyer. But right now, he's just about on the cusp of pulling him in.
The big battle is for fourth, because Dove has lost touch with Kessler now, and Key is really working her.
Root Swallowtail, there's one of those crests I was talking about. By now, though, they don't have to worry about them quite as much. I noticed a big difference between the first lap out and once you've got some heat in the tires. When the heat is in the tires, Bill, you just keep that foot planted around a number of corners that were marginal before.
Riding on board with,
that's Key, I believe.
That'd be Key. There we go. Key.
He's not pulling up as quick as I thought, though.
Three car lengths back.
Now he's got it. Now.
Still plenty of time for him to do it.
Wow. Dove coming back with the way the track weaves back and forth. She breaks kind of early, though. Now Nolden sticks it up the inside. Brave stuff. Great driving by both Dove and Nolden to pull that off, because through Hohenrenn and Tiergarten, it can be a little sketchy.
So Dove falls back to sixth. Want to talk about a driver that has not had a good run. That's the 087 car of Alexei Sorokin. He qualified in third. He's back in ninth. He's all by himself. About 3 seconds to get up to Ali Hay.
Yeah, two laps done, so he's got time still to try and catch up. But just to, again, try and drive home how big and how long this place is, we're 15 minutes into the race, and we've only just gone over two laps, Bill.
And Joe, I'll give you the honor of announcing the last car on the in the top 10. You want to take that one? You're so good at it.
Thomas Andriami Harasoa.
Very good. You know, you were super califragilistic espialidocious on that one, man.
Oh, and we do have some cars in the back taking an early stop. I guess I was a little wrong here about variety, because these guys don't have to worry about the traffic that we mentioned. So it won't make too huge of a difference. The tire's really not going to get you that much lap time. Barton looks like he's taken his. The one thing you got to watch out for, Bill, is this pit lane isn't meant to be a pit lane, really. the reason they call it the industry fart is because, as you see Joseph exit it, it's for them working on basically car makers use this layout to try and test their cars. And it even has a little gas pump in there with regular old curbs, like street curbs, that are just square-sided, and you cannot go over those, especially not in this car. You will damage the car if you try and clobber over those.
We actually did a race. I did a race where I saw a car actually get hung up on that curb. It got all four tires off. That was the end of the race.
So we take a look at Nolden and Dove still going at it. Yeah, there's so many little idiosyncrasies to this circuit, Bill, that I've heard even some of the ring masters, the ringmeisters, as they like to call them, in the real world, who help run the track days around here, even they, have little things that they feel they can perfect after years and thousands of laps around this place.
As is so often the case at this layout, the cars do tend to get stretched out a bit, and that's kind of what's happening now.
Nolden and Dove certainly are. 177 is keeping him in touch.
She's trying.
This is critical, this corner, to try and make sure not to miss the apex, which Dove was a little bit off there, and get the power down early, because not only is this one of the longest straightaways up through Kesselchen Klostertal here, but you're going uphill, Bill. So every little bit of speed that you can chuck into it is going to make a difference.
In eighth position, this is Ali Hay. It's kind of, boy, Cummins is the Russian driver. Remember we talked about Sorokin, he qualified third, he had an issue, got him pushed way in the back. He's coming. I think he's going to run down Hay pretty quick.
Yeah, this is going to be a long day for Alexei, because like you said, his qualifying pace implies that he's much faster. Here's one car he's trying to pass with Hay, and he decides not to go for it. Oh, and Hay actually just pulls over. Or he missed his braking. Not sure which. One down. Yep.
So he picks up that spot. Move him up to eighth. He's got about 5.5 seconds to get to the driver of the Czech Republic, and Lubomir Morris.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure he'll get him before the day's over. Unfortunately, our helicopters and blimps are not as useful here as we are demonstrating with the cameras.
Too much foliage.
This is, God, I cannot imagine having to set up the cameras in real life for this circuit. Probably a little bit expensive.
I would think very expensive. Now look at this, Joe. The driver in fourth, Glenn Key, after getting around Dove, now has a... got a shot at Kessler.
Yeah, he is definitely going to be within the draft as they work their way through Flansgarden. Interesting thing about this right there, where you see them. Yeah, we got a good shot there of them leaping over that jump down into Flansgarden. You do get a little bit of air, and these cars are not made to leave the ground, as the wings imply. Oh, Nolden. Nolden's had an issue. This was out of Flansgarden just moments ago.
Oh, and Sauron does
the curbs.
This will be fun to watch from Sarah Dove's viewpoint here if we can get this one. He catches the inside curb and sends him across the track, I think, Joe.
Yep, that's exactly what happened. You do not want to try and climb the curbs in 99% of this circuit. This car does not like them. It gets all kinds of upset. You can damage the wing in various parts of the car, but the main thing is just upsetting the car. Here we see from Dove's view. Yep. And that's a graphic illustration, Bill, of why I say you do not want to be following another car.
She had enough room to figure out where she was going to go, so she's up to fifth. Meanwhile, let's check in on Kessler real quick because he opened it up.
Well, no, Morris, because Dove had to lift. You can see down the dotting Urhoa. Makes it look easy. All right, she's going to get back within the slipstream. Is this enough time for her to repay the favor? It just might be. Nope, she's electing to just kind of let this one play out.
But here's the deal. Oh, no, she's in the wall. And that's Alexei Sorokin going by.
Oh, she clobbers it again, trying to get into the pits. I did that at least once during my few laps. Just, you feel like you can take it that much quicker. Let's take a look at the replay. This one. This is going wrong. I think it's another case of the curb to the inside, just lifting the car up. Yeah, just that tiny little bit of curb, Bill, see? And it's interesting that the cars are having such trouble with it, Bill. See, what happens is you have to have the car raised up quite a bit because of the bumps around here. You can't really have it too close to the ground or you'll be bottoming them out. And when you have that much suspension, there's all that yaw and roll, which makes the car a lot harder to try and catch.
Got it. That makes sense. You know, I think Dove might have been a case of losing the position, then also realizing that Sorokin is coming. Remember, we talked about that. He was about 5.5 seconds back after he got around Ali Hay. Well, now the Russian driver is only about 3.5 back and has already vultured the spot of Sarah Dove. So now looking to run down his teammate, Lubomir Morris, in fourth.
I don't think we've mentioned it, but I think Hoyer took his scheduled stop, and he's back out on track. Now, unfortunately for him, he's only a little over a second behind Emre, so he did not get himself into clear track. He will once he gets past Emre, as he's got like 15 seconds up to eighth place, but this could slow him down.
Yeah, I'm not sure the reasoning on that.
I went back and looked. I didn't see him hit anything, so didn't have damage that he had coming to repair. I hear it was a minute stop. It's different from what the timing and scoring is showing. He didn't tow in. I don't think he did. How bizarre. Everybody else looking at 20-second stops, I believe. Bill, I'm stumped on this one.
Yeah, I am too. I was checking my numbers to see what might be going on. I don't know. He's back in 10th now behind Evan Emery.
You see him there riding along down through compression in the foxhole. Excuse me, no, this is working their way through Metzgefeld.
So what that does do is put Phil Reed up in the lead.
Taking a look at him. This is up through Bravery Corner, which in these cars, not too difficult. It's flat out. It's if we see anybody go side by side, that's when it's going to get kind of interesting. Watch him. Just want to point out that Key is not too far behind Kessler. It's about a second and a half gap between second and third.
He was was a little closer than I thought as they make their way through the carousel. Is that what that's called, Joe?
The carousel.
The big carousel. There's a little one a little farther down.
Unfortunately, my Italian is not very good, so I don't know if I'm getting the name right, but it's officially the Caracciola Carousel. And after the driver who basically, I guess you could say, created it, because it wasn't originally, didn't have that banking, but it was a ditch to the inside, and he used it to find some extra time, and so they were just like, oh, let's just pave all of that.
there we go. You can see that Manuel Hoyer has able to get around Evan Emery. Something doesn't seem right, Joe. You would think that Hoyer would be able to pull away.
Well, no, he's past Emery now.
Right, but he's not distancing. Well, now he's.
Well, no. Emery is, he's by him at a very fast portion of the circuit. They're okay. Just coming up through up to the carousel here. So that was okay. A long flat out section, which is why he was able to follow. I'd expect him to drop. Oh, and now he's definitely going to drop him because Emery goofed up the carousel big time.
You know, this is my favorite corner on the track. But we see, this is trickier than you think. We see many drivers have problems here.
Yeah, I was shocked at how difficult it is. And again, it comes down to these cars not really made for this sort of thing. And as soon as it got a little bit light there on the entry, you know, if a wheel gets off the ground and it hits that banking, it could take a weird bounce, which is, I think, what happened to Emery. I kind of had to, it took me a few tries to try and figure out exactly where to throw the car in there. And even then, it's difficult to figure out how much speed you can take into it, because you can slip out of that banking, and that's much slower if you find yourself on the flat. Things getting close for 11th here, Bill.
Yeah, we haven't paid much attention to these guys. This is Marvin Sluman leading David Boutelaar.
Sluman, one of the drivers that did not take a qualifying time. And I don't know how you feel about that, Bill, but he's up to 11th now after starting 21st.
Yep. Well, I like drivers to put in qualifying times, but I give them the benefit of the doubt here. Boutelaar hails right now out of the Netherlands, but he grew up in France. I have a little background information on David.
Oof, and he is catching quickly on Sluman on this portion of the circuit. Threw the bell off S. This part actually tends to scare me through that bell off S, depending on the car. The track kind of banks back and forth through each corner. And then they went through Swallow there, which I've always found difficult. A lot easier in this car since you got a fair bit of downforce. Don't ask me to do it in the Miata too many times, though.
Okay, Alistair Hay has come in for his stop.
We should stay on this. Oh, I thought, wow, for a second there, Boutelaar had a tremendous run here on the Dottinger Ho, and he's going to be well within the slipstream anyways, Bill.
Yeah, I think this is a... Well, this is a done deal until it's undone.
Yeah, I feel like somebody at some point has got to try and pull this trick of just getting in the back behind that car that just passed you and slingshotting back. But he waited a long time to get behind Boutelaar, did Sluman, yeah. So I don't think he's going to have enough time for it.
Nope, I think they'll lock into position there. Now, let me just follow up on the point I just made of Ali Hay has made his stop. And he's out comfortably ahead of Hoyer.
I'm seeing Ali Hay in sixth, actually.
Yeah, that's sixth.
Yeah. So, I see what you're saying.
Pit it. Yeah. Because we were talking about Hoyer who made
Hoyer
that stop.
Must have had an issue then that we missed. Mentioned, was it Morris gaining on Sorotkin, or was it the other way around?
No, it looks like Sorotkin was trying to run down Morris, and he got him. So now he has moved up into fourth.
Only one spot down from where he started. It's a nice recovery from the Russian.
He got Alistair Hay on the track. Then we saw him vulture Sarah Dove. Then was able to run down his teammate Morris. Now up to fourth. 10 seconds to get to Glen Key.
Sorry, I can't resist, Bill. Is this a case of in Soviet Russia, track races you?
Oh, that was really good.
I don't think this battle is over by any means. Through the lot of links they go, and Morris really wants it back. He is clinging to the back of him.
We can stay on it. I just tell you that Evan Emre made his stop. He's going to cycle out in 12th ahead of John Roberts.
Very much just about minimizing your steering inputs up this hill. The incredible thing, this is not a slow car, though. And even with the power that it has, your speed starts going down. It's so steep climbing up what is literally a mountain here. This isn't just a hill you're going up. You're going up a literal mountain.
This track is so big. It's one of the only track. Well, it is the only track on iRacing where I actually get a feeling of going from one place to another.
That's
you know
for sure.
What I mean? It's like you can feel yourself go down the hill and then up the hill.
It feels scenic even in the game, and I can only imagine how gorgeous and how hard it is not to be distracted in the real world trying to drive this thing.
What you're looking at this to make sure that everyone, we're looking at Sorokin that's ahead of Morris. There they are.
Yeah, we can see he's just clinging to the back of him. They're pretty even on pace, it seems, or at least close enough on pace that Morris is not letting go, but I'm seeing him blink a bit, unfortunately, on my screen. Near the 66 is... not going to want that to happen if they start getting close, especially late in the race.
Just to follow up on the early leader, Manuel Hoyer, racing in, my timing and scoring won't show it to me. Look over here. Well, that's about 14th spot, I guess. We haven't talked much about Ryan Walker today. He's in eighth spot, up five from where he qualified. Still needs to make a pit stop.
Yeah, he's chasing Thomas there, the number 74. This is up towards Ashbrook, where we saw that mistake from Hoyer.
The gap about a half second. So if Walker can hang in here, he should be close enough to be in the tow when they finally make it around to the straight.
Yeah, they're going to have a little bit of a lift, maybe a little break in here into Flan's Garden. And then you can try and go flat out here in this left-hander. I think that was where Nolden wrecked. But again, it's a big crest, and you got to be careful about how much steering you're put in. Ooh, big mistake there from Andrea Maharasoa. But really not much of a place for a pass. Walker has nothing to do except just wait behind him. Now, Gallows Hill is also going to be incredibly important here, Bill. Because you can just get through there flat out. And you want to carry as much speed as you can because it's definitely flat out here. And you can see how much wide Andrea Maharasoa goes and how much it compromises him because Walker is already getting ready to go side by side here.
Well, we're looking at this report that our leader came in for a pit stop, Phil Reed. He cycles out in second. Ahead of Key, who did not make a stop. That gives the lead to Patrick Kessler.
Looks like Morris has stopped as well. Lubomir Morris.
Yeah, let me correct myself. Key did make a stop. as did Sorokin. They all came in. The only driver not to pit now of the big names is Kessler.
And he has no reason to try and pit right now. He just wants to keep that out there until he has to come in. Unless he's got someone on the box letting him know that everybody else has pitted, then he could probably come in and pit, but we don't know if anybody out here has a crew chief helping them out.
And as I was talking about the pit stops, it was Walker that was trying to run down Adriano Herrera-Soas. Am I correct on that, Joe? Because now Walker's out in front. So he must have got that pass made.
Yep, he got it on the dot Interhoa. We saw it on screen.
There we go.
So at this point, we're just waiting on Kessler to get a real image of where things sit.
Reed's got 8 seconds back to, it would be Glenn Key. Glenn Key's got 10 seconds back to Alexei Sorokin. Boy, they are all spread out.
We still got 25 minutes. We're only just barely past halfway here, Bill. So there's a lot of racing left to go.
Closest battle on the track is between the two teammates of Sorokin and Morris.
We had a unique issue from Marvin Sluman, I think. He took his pit stop, but I think because the turn into the pit lane is so tight, he didn't realize exactly where his pit stall was, and he had to back up to get to it because he had passed it up. He couldn't see it around the corner.
Boy, that's an inconvenient spot, yeah.
Oh, here we go. Now, we're not going to be able to see his crew. He can. But watch this. He's like, oh, wait,
this
wait,
works.
Wait. Yep. Now, thankfully, he didn't go too far past. You can get disqualified, even in the pits, for backing up too far.
So Marvin gets that done. He is in 12th. He's not the last car. Uh-oh. Marvin spins it. Marvin, you got 13 seconds to get this thing straightened out before Luke Barden gets to you. And now you got going.
Great job just locking him up and try to keep it from going into a barrier. Did get on top of the curb. That might have damaged the undertray slightly. But like you said, he has the ability to kind of just back this off a little bit and feel the car out before he goes flat out through parts of this.
We look at our leader. I'll go ahead and talk about the last car out there racing. That's Luke Barden. Remember, he had that win. And actually, he is not up to speed. He's having a hard time even keeping it with Marvin Sluman. So Luke not feeling good.
Kessler up at the top of the hill now, or almost to the top of the hill.
So here's the rules. The driver can put in as much fuel as they like. They just have to come in and make a stop. They have to change two tires, two fronts or two rears, whatever they prefer. So there's no reason Kessler has to come in right now. He could stay out as long as he doesn't have to pit on the very last lap. Which at this place could sneak up on you.
Yeah, you really need to be watching that clock if you plan to try and go late. So far, relatively smooth drive here for Kessler, though, but we need to watch to see how he and Reed play out. Boy, Phil Reed, having started this race in sixth, looking at a win, that's no mean feat. And just goes to show how difficult this place is, because we've seen some of our top drivers really scamper away from the field. And some of them, in cases like our pole sitter, Bill, couldn't even finish the first lap.
Yeah, it was very telling indeed.
And we talked about those points that there's no way to make them up in a second heat here today. So Oosterkamp, I think, let's see, it goes down to 20th, correct?
Right, he'll
I guess 1 point, I believe.
Yeah, whatever points he scores probably won't even count by the time he'll just wipe those away. What's happening is, in the standings, Kessler continues to be consistent. Oosterkamp continues to burn his drop races, so eventually it's going to catch up to the defending champion. I'm talking about Oosterkamp. Let's see if Patrick decides to come in this time.
See, up through Antonius Beach, under the bridge. Going about 145, 150 miles an hour along this portion of the track before you break there. And I think he's in.
All right. Reed is going to make the pace. Reed's already by. Well, there he goes, right by right now. The question is, what about Key?
Key's coming up around turn 13. Let's see, Kessler. Oh, he's going to get him.
He's going to get him.
I think he's going to be out just ahead of Sorokin. Yep. Going to be just a few seconds between third and fourth place.
So it's going to take a little while for timing and scoring to adjust, but Reed is out in front by about 9 seconds over Glenn Key. And look at this. Alexei Sorokin, remember we documented him, Joe? He was well in the back, working his way up. Well, he's up to third.
I'm seeing him in fourth, actually, because Kessler got out in third.
Oh, I apologize. That's right. Kessler got out in front of him. And then, so he has about 4.5 seconds to get to Kessler.
So we talked about survival at the start of the show, Bill. Out of 21 starters, I'm seeing 13 cars still out on track at the moment. And we got just under 20 minutes to go.
Last one being Luke Barton, who is really just limping it around.
Well, I mean,
what his last lap time was.
He's still on the lead lap, so if anybody falls out, that's more points. Andriana Harasoa, I think, was our last pitter. He just went in, or does Boudelaar still need one? See, Boudelaar and Embray with zeros next to mine, but I think they pitted.
I think Ryan Walker might still need to make one, if my timing and scoring is correct. Ryan Walker and Walker. John Roberts, maybe.
Oh. I see Walker having made one.
Okay.
This track, is messing with our timing and scoring because their cars are so far apart.
Yeah, Walker currently in seventh.
Man,
well, Director, can you find us a battle out there? You got anything for us?
I've not seen anybody close enough here, Bill.
Why don't we take this opportunity? Let's just run through the field, and Joe will just take them one at a time. I'll do first, you do second. Our leader, Phil Reed, up by almost 9 seconds on the man in second. Joe, who's that?
Well, that would be Glenn Key, who started this race in fourth. So not a huge jump, but we've seen other top drivers have issues. So this is, to me, a good performance from Key. And we'll net him quite a few points. What about third place?
Kessler started in fifth, worked his way up to the front there with the pit strategy, has fallen back to third. He's got about 7 seconds on the man who's chasing him.
That would be Lubomir Morris, who started in ninth. Our first big climber, because Phil Reed went up from sixth to first. But still, ninth to fourth for Lubomir Morris, who also having a bit of issues with his connection. We talked about that earlier. He's going to want to hope that those hold still. Thankfully, he doesn't have anybody to race against. But he's 5 seconds ahead of the next car, Bill.
And something must have happened to Alexei Sorokin, because Sorokin was ahead of Morris when we last checked in. And now he's about 5 seconds behind, so must have made a mistake. Probably has the pace to run him down, racing in fifth right now. Who's in sixth?
It's a big jump back to Ali Hay, 21 seconds behind Alexei Sorokin right now in that number 09. And he doesn't have a car close behind him. So Right now, Allie's probably just thinking, all right, let's finish this race. Let's focus on what's ahead of me and not worry about any of the other cars.
Can we go to Marvin Sluman? He's had some issues. Just happened right now. It was going on for quite a while. I think he damaged the car and then took it back out on the track. It went on for quite a while.
All right, this is out of Fluke Plots through Cottonborn. And then he's going to go off at the Swedish Cross, but this is really unusual. Okay, we can see some damage on the right front, so maybe lacking a little bit of downforce, but it should still be pretty easily flat out. Car just understeers off into the grass. Maybe he turned in too late, I'm watching from that onboard replay. Whatever the case, the results were a day being done for Sluman.
So that means that Luke Barden is going to vulture a spot. He gets up into 12th. On our rundown, where do we leave off? Did we get to Allie Hay?
Yeah, I was just about to hand you over for 7th place.
All right, let's talk about Ryan Walker. Having a nice run, qualified in 13th, so obviously up 6 positions. He's got about 30 seconds gap. Until he gets to, look how this worked out. Joe gets this name.
I was going to say, I think you did this on purpose. Thomas Andriami Harasoa sits in 8th spot. And as Bill mentioned, really in no man's land, because he's even got 17 seconds to the car behind. So he's not seen anybody around. So the fans have probably checked out and just see a single car go by until they suddenly check out again, which is takes us back to 9th. Kevin Emre looking at a top 10 today, and I believe we saw him fighting a little bit earlier on in the race, but since then hasn't had a whole lot of action as he works his way through the carousel. Just has to wrap this one up to get a nice little notch in his belt. Let's go to 11th.
Right, Emre, we're looking at John Roberts. Now, Emre was having that battle with Manuel Hoyer. Hoyer's had to call it a day since then, but right now we're looking at the man in 11th, up 8 spots. Oh, let me correct myself. Bad math. Up 6. And this is John Roberts. And he's in 11th. And really, Joe, there's only one more car out there in 12th.
That would be Luke Barton. He's got a 45-second gap up to Roberts. But we've talked about he's kind of just out there running a comfortable pace, trying not to push the car too hard. In fact, he's missing his nose right now, we can see. So doesn't have much downforce. But unfortunately, Cyrano out there is going to not be able to vulture much unless people wreck.
3 minutes and 6 seconds behind the leader. That is Phil Reed.
And all of them on the lead lap.
It's all about rhythm now. Yes, this is great for us backmarkers. We love it. There's one thing about this one. It's easy to finish on the lead lap here.
And you really don't want to be catching backmarkers at this track anyways. The blue flags in iRacing, for those not familiar, are only informational. You don't get punished for not pulling over. So if you come across someone stubborn, it can make life hell around the green.
Ryan Walker making that pit stop. I think our timing scoring was correct. So he does come in from 7th. I think he's going to be able to come in and get out. Still comfortably ahead of Tommy Adriami Harasoa.
Yeah, nice 7th spot solidified for, appropriately, the 007.
Uh-huh. There you go.
Bill, as much as I know you like bringing out your show tunes, I think we can carry this one to the end. There's only 12 minutes to go.
We got it. We got it. We're fine.
About our second place driver. This is really the closest two that we've got between Key and Kessler, about 5 seconds, which is not impossible. I mean, Kessler, if he starts to push and if we see some mistakes from Key, that could close down.
Yeah, the gap is close enough where you still have to do a little bit of racing.
So back down into the valley, we watch them go. That's Key there in second.
While we're looking at Kessler in What would he be racing in there in third spot? Let's go ahead and mention some of the big names that are out. Renee Osterkamp. He's not going to score. Well, he's finishing in 20. Joe mentioned he's going to pick up 1 point. Some other drivers are just going to pick up a few. Kerry Nolden. That's a big name. Sarah Dove, we saw her up front. She's going to finish in 15th.
You know, we can't stress enough here, Bill, how hard it is to learn this track, for one, and then also to learn to be fast as well. If any of these drivers had not already memorized this track in another car, they had a very steep climb ahead of them during practice on the week. And the thing about it is that it's not just a matter of like trying to find outright pace, but even completing the full race distance, which is what we saw here. It takes so long with 6.5 minute laps, Bill. You know, in most tracks, if you practice for about an hour, you're probably going to be pretty solid about, you know, where you're good, where you can push, what the danger zones are. Only being out here for an hour, let's see, what lap are we on? Lap 8 right now? 8 laps. And that's practicing for about an hour, Bill.
Yeah, absolutely. When I was learning the track, first thing I did was get out in my comfortable MX-5. I did a few corners and said, this track is way too pretty to have a roof on top of me. So I put it in and got into the Skippy where I could see how beautiful this track really is.
I hate to tell you, but the MX-5 doesn't have a roof in this game, Bill. It's a convertible.
Oh, well. You know, you're right. It is. There were the roll bars.
You've run a series with the MX-5 for 5 or 6 years now, Bill.
What was I thinking? What was the roll bars running in my way?
That is one for GSRCs.
You're right. There is no roof on the MX-5. Come on. We got 9 minutes to go.
Director, can that one go on our weekly highlights?
No, that one will not go on the weekly highlights. Okay. We'll put that one in the archives.
Looking at Sorokin in fifth. This is going to be a nice one for Sorokin, I have to say. Even if he doesn't, if he finishes lower than he started, since he was third on the grid. We keep saying it, but it's very important. This is a nice haul of points, and Sorokin's kind of been up and down this season. So this is a finish that 087 really wanted to be good, now that he's guaranteed more points than he usually would for a third or fifth place.
Another big name that's going to score small is Manuel Hoyer, sitting in 14th.
One thing I loved for poor Dougie Beard to get cameras set up. He basically has one television camera, and then from there it's everything else. These onboards, the blimps, and whatnot. Yeah. And I'm not going to complain about that. I could just sit and watch and see what these drivers are doing, especially now that the over under of the crossover on the hands are on every car. You get a real sense of what every driver is doing in the cockpit.
We had 21 drivers sign up to race this one. We got 12 out there. Just a little bit over half. Joe, that's about what we usually see on these things.
Attrition, yeah, I'm not always a big fan. I'm not too shocked about how many are finishing at this point. I wish we could have seen more drivers out there, because it would have been made more interesting. So here's my challenge to all the AOR drivers next season, if they bring this track back, is get out here. Try it. Don't shy away. It's I know it's tough, but it's a fun challenge.
And you get three drop races, and we promise to be kind here at GSRC. Come on out.
So we take a look at our leader, Reed.
Honestly, if my 95-year-old mother-in-law had decided to race, she probably could finish 14th. She'd be in the points.
You keep denying her getting on the iRacing service. This is the one to send her out for.
You can go ahead and limp that car around.
Barton's still going. He needs to change that car to be pink. Put a drum on the back of it.
Yes. His last lap was a 7 minute one. That's a touch off of his best, which was a 7.1.2. It's been a long day for him.
Yeah, it really has. But, I mean, this is a Dory Award for sure. Credit to him for keeping the car going, trying to finish this race no matter what.
Well, he kept it out there. Marvin Sluman made a mistake, so he got that spot. And if one of the guys ahead of him happened to put it in the wall, he's on the lead lap. He'll pick up those spots as well.
One in front of him right now is the 86 of John Roberts. He's got about over a minute ahead of Barton.
I think, Joe, you were on the race that we called here where a driver crashed the car about halfway around on the last lap and
was had limping to limp at home. Yeah. The slowest nail biter we ever had. I remember that. It was a fun one. As we jump up to Key.
They'd pass him.
Well, I think Key put the kibosh on that battle. Because it was about 5 seconds before, and it's now up to 7 seconds. He seems to be faster than Kessler. That, or Kessler has backed it off and is just trying to solidify this third place for his SimRC team.
Yeah, I want to talk a little bit about teams here real quick, because it's going to be a great day for Morris and Sorokin. Those guys are going to really score well. Think about this. Phil Reed, his partner is Kerry Nolden. Well, Nolden is way down the order. Glenn Key, of course, he's teamed up with Manuel Hoyer. Hoyer's not going to score a lot of points. Patrick Kessler, those guys are leading for SimRC. Well, he's teamed up with Osterkamp. Osterkamp's going to get 1 point. But then you get to Lubomir Morris and Alexei Sorokin. Those guys are teammates. They're going to come home fourth and fifth. That's fourth and fifth in this single race format. Going to be huge points for that team.
We see Sorokin heading up Kesselchen now. Now, something that I'm kind of paying attention to, because I was curious if we're going to get the white flag. It's looking kind of close on whether or not we'll get it with Phil Reed. So
we're getting information
that he's got one more. Yeah. Now, here's the reason I bring this up, Bill. We talked about the pit stops and whatnot. And we've mentioned in other tracks about how you want to make sure that you put enough fuel in so that you if you get an extra lap, you're not caught out. This one, you really want to make sure you put a little bit of leeway on the fuel, unless you're darn sure about where you're going to finish on laps.
You need an extra 6.5 minutes of fuel if you figured it wrong. With an 8 second lead, he could maybe slow down and let us all go home 6.5 minutes early, but I don't think so.
Well, the problem with that, Bill, is that basically iRacing is estimating the lap. So if you back off, it still won't give you the checkered flag sometimes. And that would put him in an even worse position, because now not only is he have to really save, but he's just given away the lead that he had. And speaking of that lead, Key's chopped off about a second and 2/10 since I last looked. What's going on there?
Down to 7.6 between them.
Reed's heading through the bell off S, 2 minutes to go. I still don't know. Kind of remember, I wish I would have watched to see how long it takes to get down the Dottie Nerho while I was practicing, because I'm not entirely sure if it's about a minute, which is, I think, what he's going to have. Maybe a little bit more. Here's the Gallows Hills right here. This is something I don't think we thought that we'd have to deal with. I think he's got one more, Bill.
Yeah, I think he's going to get there before. He'll get the white flag after he goes underneath the timing and scoring.
Let's watch to see him go by just to make sure, but Just want to note that Alexei Sorokin is getting close to Lubomir Morris.
Can I practice my victory call this time around, or I should probably wait? Yeah.
All right, so white flag is out for Reed. We do have a battle for the last lap potentially here. We say battle with 3 seconds apart.
Well, keep in mind, Sorokin was ahead of Morris. He made a mistake out there and lost that.
It's closing. It's under 3 seconds now.
2.8, yeah, he is coming. Of course, remember, they are teammates, so if it is a battle, it'll be a friendly battle.
Have you not watched F1, Bill? Friendly yes. Does not always go with teammates all the time.
Oh my goodness, he's chopped off a bunch more time now.
Yeah, Sorokin is on the go.
Any other track? 2.3 second lead on the last lap. It's a cakewalk home, but not here. Oh my. Yeah. He's coming, and he's coming fast.
And what's more important is now he's got him within his view. That makes you push all the harder, which could be a good or a bad thing, depending on the type of driver you are. But mentally, it's also important.
He is coming so fast, I almost wonder if Lubomir maybe didn't think he had to go this extra 6.5 minutes.
It could be. He might be saving fuel. Because I don't remember him closing in this fast before.
Unless they want to have a team photo.
How much do you trust your teammate?
All this going on behind Phil Reed, who's comfortably out in the front.
Yeah, what we saw with that going down is slowed up significantly. It's about 7.3, so he's still catching him, but not at a high rate of knots. Ooh, Sorokin made a mistake into Adenauer Forst. Let's take a look at the replay. This would be a good onboard. This is a difficult place to slow up the car because you effectively come into here out of compression. We'll get a good view down to the foxhole. Compression is the bottom end up valley. You're lifting a little bit through here, and then you're braking as you're turning left and right, or right and left, I should say. And just, you lost it, probably pushing that a little bit too hard and got up under the curb, but saved it. It didn't hurt him too much though, Bill, because he's down to a little over a second now.
Yep. Boy, he is really pushing it because he gains a lot, and then he gives a lot away as well. As now is up to 1.4. Mm. This might be a case where we see more than one pass down that long straightaway.
Oh yeah, I doubt that Morris is going to be giving it up that easily if he gets by him early. Back down to 1.3. It was up to 1.5 for a bit. Well, Lexi's got to get himself together. He's got to shake off these mistakes and stop overdriving the car. Just remember to hit the marks that he's been hitting, because that's brought him this far. When you start to change things up, Bill, that's when you make mistakes.
Nothing makes me drive slower than when I'm trying to run down a guy that I can see. Got to be a little bit closer to get the toe.
Yeah, he's right on the cusp. So unfortunately, Alexi's gonna have to try and gain on him up at the top of the hill here, where there's curves that he's got to hope that he's faster than Lubomir. Or maybe through here. Maybe he can gain time through the carousel. Let's see how they sit after that.
Oh, yeah, he's there now.
Oh, yeah, he gained about 0.3 in that section. But we saw him get this close a little bit before on this lap. Just got to stick with it. Got to make sure you don't keep your eyes on that car. Keep your eyes on the road that you're racing. And if anything, that's not just about hitting your own marks, Bill, but also about target fixation. It's much easier to try and avoid something based on your peripheral vision, because you have quicker reaction times using your peripheral vision. So that's why Alexi doesn't want to just sit there and look at that car. If he can see that little bit of odd movement out of the corner of his eye, he'll be able to react and try to avoid him that little bit easier. I don't think we're going to get to watch this, though, because our leader's getting to the end of the lap now, Bill.
Out of Swallowtail, he'll be full throttle here pretty soon. Yep.
Clear sailing from here on out.
It's about 28 seconds back from the leader, back to Morris and Sorokin. So as soon as we see our leader go across the line, we'll assume that Key and Kessler come in second and third. We'll jump right back to Morris and Sorokin and see what's going on there.
Great race for AOR Orange today. Boy, I don't know what was with Reed's qualifying, but from sixth to first here at the ring, he deserves a round of applause for this drive.
Yep. Got a good start, able to avoid trouble. Now just a few more corners.
Take him home, Bill.
One last right-hander to go. Round number seven, the AOR Formula Renault 2.0 Challenge goes to Bill Reed.
Soroka just made the move. He slingshot past. Oh, sorry, we're looking at the rest of our podium. Was Key out of gas?
Key must have run out of gas. Kessler gets second. Key will get third. Sorokin gets around Morris. Sorokin will get fourth. Morris will settle for fifth. My goodness, as Glenn Key. Everybody else coming across. I'm just checking to see what might have happened.
That's a relief for Kessler, because that gifts him one more spot right at the very end.
Key actually got loose, too, at the very end.
Figuring out that fuel is so important as we watch.
So we're looking at that. Key was clearly out of fuel. He was wiggling the car back and forth. I'm not sure if that actually works in iRacing.
I don't think it does, actually. Giving everybody a little bit of screen time.
So, Joe, as we look at the guys coming across, sure enough, that extra lap did play a role, though.
We wondered if it would.
Lee has a second's position.
Let me check to see if anybody else is a little slow here at the end. We watch Thomas take an eighth spot. Oh, and sorry, Dove, getting on the chat, mourning the fact that she was hoping for a good race with Kessler. Beetle are going to come home ninth. Where is Barton?
Oh, he was...
He's still coming up to the top of the hill.
He was 4 minutes and 30 seconds behind the leader.
I don't think we're going to wait for him to get to the line.
Even if he were to put it in the wall, he would still get 14th position. So, Rolling Thunder, Evan Emery is going to pick up... what would that be for him? A top 10 for him?
Yeah, just top 10. In there. John Roberts just outside of it. And I think that's going to close it up here, Bill. These guys don't look like they're going to be changing position.
What we'll do right now is we'll take a short break. Then we'll come back and we'll talk to some of the drivers after we run down the entire finishing order. Don't go far. This is sanctioned by the Apex Online Racing folks. Welcome back to the Global Sim Racing Channel's coverage of the Formula Renault 2.0 Season 10 Championship. This is round 7 from the ring. It is done, and it was Phil Reed who came from 6th position, picked up a few spots early, avoided some of the chaos that happened on the early lap, was able to bring it home in first. Congratulations on that. Patrick Kessler was able to snake 2nd position as Glenn Key ran out of fuel and had to limp it across. Yes, that extra 6.5 minutes of racing that Joe talked about mattered to the Norwegian driver, as Glenn Key has to settle for 3rd. Alexis Sorokin also got the best of his teammate, Lubomir Morris. They come home 4th and 5th. The back half of your top 10, it's Ali Hay, Ryan Walker with a quiet 7th place finish. In 8th, it is Tommy Adriami Hirasoa. In 9th, it is David Pupillar. And then rounding out your top 10, Evan Roland Thunder Imre. Joe?
John Roberts will get in 11th, though. He started 17th, so he went up the same amount of spots that Emery did, followed him through. Luke Barton was the last car to actually finish. He took a 12th. Marvin Sluman is your first DNF in 13th, with Manuel Hoyer, shockingly, finishing in 14th today. Also DNFing. Sara Dove could have looked at a potential podium there, but we'll have to settle for 15th place. After an error on trying to enter pit lane. Scott Newton gets 16th, with Kerry Nolden in 17th, falling afoul of the exit of Flansgarden. Joseph Ringrose will finish 18th, and then P19 goes to Daniel Morris. Renee Osterkamp, our pole sitter, 20th place, a single point goes to Renee. And then Tom Van Hoymen finishes in 21st. Bill?
Okay, I'm able to talk to the man who had 2nd place locked up. And it's Glenn Key. Glenn, I got to guess fuel on the last lap?
No.
What happened?
I'm all shaky. So the final carousel thing where Phil did a mistake.
Yes.
I got kind of caught up, and I did the same mistake as he did. And I just kept sliding straight into the wall. And with the direct drive wheel, you can really get that feeling in the hand, so I think I sprayed my but I got suspension damage, and I just had to hustle it in the whole straight whilst Patrick was catching me. And then at the final corner, he caught up to me, and then it was just over. But a 3rd place, I wouldn't say I'm disappointed. It was a really, really I don't know about the stream, the broadcast, but for me personally, it was a big workout, and huge, huge congrats to Phil and Patrick, and even Sarah, who I was battling with at the beginning. Some amazing battles throughout the race, but yeah, I'll take the 3rd and bring the points with me, for sure.
Yeah, it could have been worse. You could have ended up not being able to limp the car home. That makes sense. I saw your car weaving back and forth down the straight. I thought you were shaking it for fuel there, but clearly the car wasn't handling well.
You almost
got it there. This goes a lesson learned that it's never over until it's over.
Well, yeah, I kept praying that where's Phil? Corner after corner, and then all of a sudden I see him, and then boom. That's it.
All right. Well, congratulations. 3rd place, though. Big points, because this is a single race event. This is still going to be huge points for you and your team.
Yeah, indeed.
All right. Glenn Key, our 3rd place finisher today.
We have 7th waiting to talk to us, Ryan Walker. Kind of looked quiet from our perspective, but I'm sure being in the cockpit, it was exciting for the 60 minutes that you had to try and navigate the ring. Right, Ryan? Ryan, do you have a copy? Trying to get Ryan Walker's mic hooked up here in a second. We'll give him just a little bit longer. Ryan, of course, started 13th, so he climbed 6 positions there to get up to where he did. And it looks like we're not getting anything from Ryan. Just one more try, Ryan.
Hello?
There we go. Now we got Ryan with us.
Sorry about that. My microphone is muted by accident.
No worries. So... Talk to us about the race. I mean, was it difficult for you? Or are you used to driving the ring?
I've raced around here a few times, but not in the former Renault. The only time I've raced around here is was in the Nürburgring 24 hours earlier this year, and the Skip Barber. This was my first time in the former Renault, but to finish in P7 after starting in the pits, I'll happily take that.
So what was your method about this race? Were you just kind of not worrying about anybody else, just focus on driving the track, or did you actually try to gain positions and push to get up there?
The plan going into the race was just not to worry about lap times and not to push too much, just lap at a pace that I was comfortable with, and just let everyone else do their own thing and just get to the finish and pick up some points, and managed to do that.
We saw a little bit of lower attendance today with this race. So if it comes back on the schedule, do you think you would return for the Nordschleife?
Oh yeah, definitely. I would return. I mean, it was still a decent turnout, but at the same time, it was disappointing. I don't know why more people don't race it. I mean, when I was in the practice session before qualifying, there was maybe one or two people complaining about the track, saying it was stupid. But most of the time, when I seen them complaining, they were crashing. So yeah, probably explains it.
Understandable. Well, again, congratulations on a seventh in, climbing up five or six places, and we will see you next week.
Thanks, Joe.
That was Ryan Walker, seventh place finisher, and I believe our winner has joined us. Bill, have you caught up with Reed?
Yeah, he was slow getting here. He had some celebration to do. Phil Reed, our winner, made it to the interview booth. Phil, congratulations. That was a good one.
Yeah, thank you. As you say, it's a long in-lap at Nordschleife, so, you know, took me some time. Finally, I have won a race in the Formula Renault in a non-sprint race format race. So it's taken me 10 seasons, but it's finally happened.
Really?
Yeah.
I would have lost a bet there. I would have swore that you had won a feature race before now.
No, it's been a combination of me not being as strong in the Formula Renault and the competition being much faster than it used to be. So yeah, it's been a tough one. I've come close a few times, but finally here it's happened, and I may not sound it, but I'm so happy.
Any close calls out there today?
Yes, there was a couple. I had one on lap one with Rene where we were side by side through one of the corners. I'm not sure. There's too many to remember.
Right.
We were through them, and I think I clipped the curb slightly and jumped a little bit out. But there wasn't any contact, but I think Rene got scared a little bit prior to that, knowing that I was going down the inside. So he sort of straightened up the wheel to give me more room, but then couldn't keep it on the track, so he went into all, which is really unfortunate for him. He definitely does not deserve that. But yeah, there's a couple of others. And also on the final lap, coming through the second carousel, thought it would be funny to spin. You know, got a 10-second or so lead. You know, it's quite comfortable. Why not just throw it away? But I got lucky with Glenn also doing the same thing, it seems. So, good.
We didn't catch that. But the last thing we know is we saw that Glenn had issues and lost that second-place position, finishing in third. One last question. We'll get you out of here on this. I think I know the answer, but was there any concern about fuel having to go that extra 6.5 minutes, or did you know how many laps it was going to be?
No, I was good on fuel. I filled way too much in the pit stop, so I was all good. What I say is I filled enough to do the in-lap. That's what it is.
That's why it took you so long. Got it. Hey, well, congratulations on the big one. Hey, this is huge points, baby, on these single race events.
Massive points. It's brilliant. I have no idea where this is going to put me. I'll find out in about 20 or 30 minutes when I update the results. So,
I think there's some info right now on that, actually. Sorry to interrupt.
Oh, interesting.
We're seeing, we're getting reports that it'll put you up into second, and actually Renee will be down to third.
Ah, so that'll take Patrick up into lead, but that makes sense, I guess.
Yep.
Wow, third. Wow. I suppose it's a big one. I mean, Renee's still, there's still so much of the championship left. And I think, but it's you know, I think Renault's had a quite unfortunate run in the last few races, and it's, I mean, I think he might have used all of his drop weeks now.
I think now he's spent all the casino money now. He's racing. He's everything's going to cost him his own stuff now. Hey, congratulations on the win. Long time coming. Good job.
Thank you very much. Take care, guys.
Bill Reed. You can tell Joe's getting close to the end of the season. They're starting to think about the championship. And I think that's going to do it for us here at the... Oh, no, we don't. We have got Evan Imbray is going to come in.
Yep. We've got Evan with us now that I've made my way back into the booth. Somebody kicked me out there for a second. And Evan managed to get a top 10 today after starting at 16th. We were talking to Ryan about his finish earlier. Do you consider this a win for yourself, getting a top 10 out here at the ring?
Yeah. I mean, completing one lap is an achievement here, because driving a single seat around here is just so on the edge. Even if, like me, you're 15 seconds off the pace, it's really scary. But last season I beached it on the kerbs, and today I've finally managed to finish a race for the first time around the Nordschleife. So, it's a good day overall.
What do you consider the most challenging part of this track? What gave you the most trouble where you found it in the Armco at practice?
it would be basically the second half of the track, because I've crashed so many times in the first half of the track that I know the first half of the track really well, and I don't know the second half that well. I don't know the track because I haven't made it that far usually, because I usually crashed. So the first half of the track's fairly easy, and then when you get all the over the crest hills and fast corners in the second half, it, unless you know the track, then you're just guessing.
Yeah, that is for sure. One last question before we let you go. Next round, we are going to the newest circuit here on the roadside, Detroit. Have you bought it yet? Have you driven there?
Yeah, I bought it. I drove a couple of laps around there on the IndyCar, but the Formula Renault is going to be a bit different, because if you hit the kerbs quite hard, because they are quite high kerbs, then it's going to destroy the front wing immediately, because you know how fragile the front wings are on this car. So it's going to be a test to keep an eye on the wall. I'm looking forward to it, because it's like a street track, and we haven't got many of those. I'm not sure if we've got any of them, but it's going to be a challenging test.
I can tell you from being there in real life, it actually is a street course. So, well, look forward to seeing you try and drive there for the first time AOR visiting, and we hope to see you again.
Okay, thanks, Joe.
Was Evan Embray, 10th place finisher here today, Bill. And that's going to close it up for real this time.
Hey, we'd like to thank everybody at Apex Online Racing for organizing the Formula Renault 2.0 League, and to all the members who supported this broadcast. We know you have a lot of choices when you fly. Thanks for flying GSRC. Thanks to the company's equipment and software that you see on the screen right now that we use on the broadcast. The original music that gives every GSRC production that unique flavor and feel is thanks to Eric Eckholm and June Lalonde. See the screen to how to contact each of them. Joe?
AOR returns in 1 week like we usually do, August 3rd. That'll be next Friday. And as I said, we're going to Detroit's Belle Isle Circuit. We'll be back again for full coverage, and we look forward to you joining us. If you'd like more information about GSRC, including a complete list of future broadcasts, you can find it at globalsimracingchannel.com. We're also on Twitter at GSR Channel, Facebook at Global Sim Racing Channel, and for Instagram, we are at GSRC_Graham.
Finally, on behalf of the man whose voice you just heard, Joe Peek, our director, Sean Krakus Ambrose, and our camera artist, Dougie Beard, I'd like to thank all of you for watching. With that said, we're off to have fun storming the castle. So until next time, race clean, race hard, and we'll see you on the track.